Hi everyone, my name is Thibaut Ghiberti. I'm a research scientist at KAUST, and I would like to describe a new diagnostic technique which we developed for the single-shot imaging of major species and NOH malfunctions and temperature in non-premixed hydrogen flames at elevated pressure. And this is a collaborative work between two groups at KAUST, one group of Professor William Roberts and the group of Professor Magnotti. So multiscalar and time-resolved measurements in turbulent flames are needed, and the current golden standard is the measurement of all major species and temperature using 0D or 1D Raman Rayleigh scattering. There are a number of groups in the world capable to do this, and when they do this with very high accuracy and precision, a couple of percent, but these very good numbers, they are currently limited to 1D or 0D due to the weakness of the Raman signal. These experiments are very useful because they reveal the thermochemical structure of flames. So the data is typically plotted as scatter plots. For example, here you'll find scatter plots which I took from the literature. This one is showing major species malfractions as a function of mixed fraction. This one temperature as a function of mixed fraction. And so someone that has experience with these diagnostics and scatter plot can instantly recognize the kind of flame. So here someone will recognize a diffusion hydrogen flame. And here for the Sydney burner with mixed modes of combustion, one will recognize sometimes diffusion mode or premix mode or diffusion mode with evidence of local extinction. And so this is important because most practical flames neither are strictly premixed nor non-premixed. And of course, extending this to 2D might be very useful because we might obtain more spatial information, including gradients. And some attempts have been reported in the past, but to my knowledge, they were always limited to up to 3 scalars. And one notable example is a study from Kelman and Masri, where they measured the number density of methane in images with Raman, temperature with Rayleigh, and OH with OHPLIF. And using some assumptions, they were able to relate this data to create images of mixture fraction and scalar dissipation rate. And because they only measured the fuel, only one species, to obtain mixture fraction, they had to make strong assumptions, including one-step reaction chemistry and unity Lewis number. And of course, we know that this is not going to be valid all the time. And so this basically gives the objective of our study. We wanted to demonstrate the first simultaneous single-shot imaging of all major species, OH, mixture fraction, and temperature in a turbulent flame without having to do strong hypotheses. And we chose to do this in a nitrogen-diluted hydrogen jet flame at 12 bar. Why? Because this is only a first attempt, and hydrogen only has 4 major species, nitrogen, oxygen, hydrogen, and water. Then we know because of hydrogen, differential diffusion will play some role. And this is a nice way to make sure that the previous technique, which I described before, is not going to work. And of course, we know that pressure boosts the intensity of the Raman signal. So going to 12 bar is useful. I will first describe the multi-species 2D Raman setup, which we developed at KAUST, then go to the post-processing, also the results. And of course, I will conclude and provide some perspectives. You will find on the left a typical Raman spectra from an hydrogen flame with a laser at 532, which I took from the literature. And basically, you will see that each species has a different signature at a different wavelength. So this is spectrally resolved. We don't want that. Oops, sorry. We want spatial resolution in 2D, right? So we are going to bin this spectral information using bandpass filters and project the data onto camera pixels. And so you will see here in this figure the different bond passes which we choose for each species. And on a side note, one has to be worried about the crosstalk, specifically the hydrogen on oxygen bond pass crosstalk. This is a detailed schematic of our experimental setup. It includes everything except the laser system. So we did these experiments in the HPCD, high pressure combustion ducts. We did jet flames, so very simple burner, fuel pipe feeding hydrogen, surrounded by an air coflow, and all of this mounted on a 3-axis translation stage. One challenge with Raman scattering is the weakness of the signal intensity. So we have to improve the signal collection efficiency, which we did with in the internal relay optics. So we have 2 4-inch achromatic lenses inside the HPCD, which relay the flame signal outside. And then the signal enters the Hydra, which is our custom KAUST imaging system, which is composed by a collimator, an electro-optical shutter, a dichroic mirror assembly, and 4 low-noise CCD cameras, one for each species. So because we used non-intensified CCD cameras, we do not have nanosecond gating, so we had to develop our own way of doing gating, and we chose this to do this with a pocket cells sandwiched between 2 wire grid polarizers. And this allows us to remove luminosity from the flame. Then the signal goes through a notch filter to remove the contribution from the laser. And then we enter the dichroic mirror assembly, where basically the signal gets specially separated to separate the different contributions from the different species. And then the signal is sent towards its own camera through a bandpass filter. These are pictures taken in the lab. One would recognize the HPCD as well as the Hydra. I did not talk too much about the lasers. We used the combined output of 2 ND-YAG lasers at 532, giving us around 1.2 joule per pulse. And we also combined this Raman imaging with conventional OHPLIF. So we used here one intensified CCD camera looking through the opposite window. And we use the conventional dye laser with an output at 283 nanometer. In terms of post-processing, the first and to my opinion, the most important step is image denoising. This is a raw hydrogen image, and this is the same image after this denoising step. And we see that it is drastically less noisy. And we get this good performance because we use an advanced wavelet adaptive thresholding technique, which was developed by Dr. Matt Dunn at University of Sydney. And this technique is nice because it applies no penalty on spatial resolution and has no user bias. We then remove the background, correct it for flat field, correct it for spatial and temporal laser energy density fluctuation, and registered spatially all 5 cameras. And the final step is to convert our signals into mole fractions and temperature, which we did using the matrix inversion method. And so the needed matrix coefficient, they were inferred from experiments in laminar jets and laminar jet frames, as well as 1D opus flow simulations. It is important to note that the Raman signal intensity is a function of the number density, so both temperature and the species mole fraction. And so therefore, one has 2 options. One could also measure temperature directly, for example, with Rayleigh, and derive the mole fractions of interest using the ideal gas law. However, it was challenging for us at the time of the experiments to apply Rayleigh scattering in the HPCD, so we went with option 2, which was to measure all major species, and then we have access to one more question, sum of all major fractions equal to 1, and we can use this to infer temperature and then all mole fractions. And because all major species mole fraction and temperature were measured, we can make our OHP quantitative because we can compute quenching rates and Boltzmann population distributions. I am showing here the results of the calibration process in a laminar nitrogen diluted hydrogen non-premix jet lamp at 12 bar. Right? I'm showing the results only for 1 row of pixel and for time average data. Right? So these are mole fractions of major species plotted in physical space as a function of the radius. Symbols are experiments, lines are simulation. Right? So the simulations are multi-component transport, opus flow in Kempkin. And so basically we see that there is a good agreement between experiments and simulation after the calibration, also for temperature and OH. And so some people are more used to look at this data in mixture fraction space, which is available below. So same data, and again, we have a good agreement, a good calibration procedure. There is some discrepancy for the OH, and this is because this is for only one of the 3 calibration frames we used, 1-to-1 ratio, If we look at the data for much more diluted flame, we see that the discrepancy for OH is opposite, right? So basically, the coefficients for the matrix that we chose are the best compromise to obtain the best performance across the three flames. And based on this procedure, we're able to assess accuracy, which is always better than 10%, and precision, more important in my opinion, always better than 6% for the Raman scalars and 10% for OH. And so we consider these very good numbers considering that this is an imaging technique. Now, going to the results, I am showing you here single shot images obtained from a laminar flame, right? So these are all the scalars of interest except nitrogen, which we measured, but we excluded it because it is featureless. So these are 10 by 8 millimeter, but in fact, we are measuring 8 by 25, but this is only air, so I've excluded it as well. And so one will recognize expected features from diffusion flames, OH, H2O, high temperature layers sandwiched between the oxidizer and the fuel. What is nice is that now we can choose any region of interest we want and cast the pixels in mixture fraction space, right? So the symbol in color are the experiments and the line are a simulation with multi-component transport. And we obtain a very good agreement between experiments and simulation. And we can also populate the full mixture fraction space on a single shot, only with one set of images, right? And so the conclusion from this is that we can accurately capture the full thermochemical structure of the flame in a single shot with our new imaging technique. Of course, the target is not laminar flames, it is turbulent flames, and I'm showing here very similar results, but for a turbulent flame with a much larger Reynolds number. Sorry about that. And so again, one would recognize expected features from a diffusion flame, but now the flame is corrugated. We can choose again any region of interest we want, for example, this one, and cast the data in mixture fraction space, and we observe something very different. Agreement now is poor when compared with multi-component transport simulations, but very good compared to these dashed lines, which are the results of simulations with unity Lewis number, right? And this is somehow an expected result because it's been shown before that turbulence smears differential diffusion. So the point was not to show this with this data. The point is to show that these experiments are able to highlight the subtle influence of differential diffusion in a single shot, only using one set of images. And this lends a lot of confidence in this new imaging technique. So why would we want to go with 2D? Okay, one answer is that we can get a more accurate scalar dissipation rate, because it depends on the gradients of mixture fraction, right? So if you have 2D data, you can compute more accurate gradients compared to 1D data. Of course, ideally, you would want 3D data, but it's even more challenging to do, right? So based on these images that you've seen before, we are able to compute a single shot image of quantitative scalar dissipation rate. We believe 2D is useful because you can also increase the speed and reduce the cost of these experiments, okay, because you collect more pixels in a shorter time, and this could be eventually useful if you're running expensive fuels or if the experiments are by design short because they are blowdown, for example. So we demonstrated the first simultaneous single shot imaging of all major species, OH, temperature, and mixture fraction in hydrogen jet flames at 12 bar. We found a precision better than 6% for all the Raman scalars, 10% for OH due to the intensified camera, and with a 25 by 8 millimeter field of view. And we attribute the good performance of this Raman imaging technique to the use of low noise CCD cameras, an advanced denoising method, and resorting to elevated pressure. Of course, this technique is not limited to hydrogen. It is technically possible to extend it to other fuels by simply adding more cameras, right? Ammonia will require one more camera, syngas two more cameras, and methane three more cameras, of course, as long as it is not too sooty. So from that, I thank you for your attention, and I will be happy to answer your questions.